Oh, since 9:38 a.m. Oh, stupid camera is over here. Put it up here. And it's Wednesday. Wednesday, 5th April 2017. So yeah, I took a shower. See, I wear the same clothes all every day because I don't know. I don't know. It's just too hard. Choosing different clothes is hard. And yeah, so took a shower. But all these pimples and everything is, I don't know. So I gotta go to the job agency. Can't believe I have to. It shouldn't be this hard to get a job. I'll just sort of, just try and enjoy my life a little instead of being so serious all the time. So serious. I've been buying lots of audiobooks and also bought some Kindle books as well. Lots of audiobooks. It's nice to just sit there and listen to an audiobook because it's like someone's reading the book and you're just listening. It's like seeing a video, but because they're reading a book, it's more structured and the content is usually of a good quality. So that's one of the benefits of audiobooks. So I'm going today to hand in a police check form. I already did this for my when I went for the admission. I had to do a police check. So they're gonna do this one for the Work for the Dole program. So I might have to do like 2 days a week. I think I can work as a. Oh, that is so bad. I think I can work as a, like a. For Work for the Dole, you have to work for a non-profit organization. And I think I'll choose the. What is it? Salvation Army or something. One of these. Maybe work as a shop assistant, gain some customer service skills and experience, and I can put that on my resume and say, "See, I have customer service." But I should really be applying for. See, the problem with me is like for the jobs I'm applying for, like administration assistant, they will look at my resume and say, "Oh, you're overqualified." You know what I mean? Or they will say, "Oh, this person is not going to stay in as an administration assistant long term," obviously. So I'm like in this strange place where I am all qualified for some jobs, and then I for other jobs like what I want to do, I am underqualified or I don't have the experience. So it's like I'm in a very difficult place. I mean, everything about my life is so freaking like. I'm always like falling through the cracks. That's what I feel like. I'm falling through the cracks when it comes to even for the job. Like even there, I'm kind of unusual because I'm a long-term unemployed person. And I have these qualifications, and it's like what the fuck? It's like I'm falling through the cracks of the system. Yeah. But anyway, I gotta start somewhere. I have to start somewhere. To bring my citizenship certificate, my Medicare, and my driver's license, because I need the ID, and I want to change my gender marker, like on the I still haven't done that. Yesterday I was imagining, like, I was thinking of like changing my name to another name that I really love that name. It's just like really, I don't know, maybe I might change it later. If I am around, maybe for my when I if I'm around in a couple of years and I turn to 40, maybe before I turn 40 I will change my name. And I'm not gonna say what name it is, but I really love it. It's just like, oh, this is who I am. This name is who I am. I mean, Yvette, okay, sound, it's okay, but I don't know, I just never really gelled with that name. But for this name, it's like, such a beautiful name. So I don't know, I might change my name, but I want to change my gender marker first, because if you have a if you change your name, if your gender is still male, they'll put male even if you have a female name. It's like, because they've got these stupid, the system here is really not very friendly to trans people. No, I mean, I should get them to revise that. Hey, man, I'm a trans person. Why do you have to put the freaking thing in there? I think the federal government's approach is very good, because for that, all I needed to show was a letter from my psychiatrist, and they changed my gender. They didn't ask for surgeries or anything. But in New South Wales, obviously they're a bit more. Not up with the times. Apparently, New South Wales has got very good policies when it comes to transgender prisoners. Because if you're a trans woman in New South Wales, you will be put in the female prison, not in the male prison. And that seems like a. Well, I wouldn't. I think it's a dangerous for a trans person to be in whatever prison, where you're male prison or female prison. It's both are dangerous. So, you gotta put trans people in the, one of those, special places. I was thinking to myself yesterday, where would they put the trans? They probably put us with the. No, it's not funny, but I was thinking, like, they might put us with the pedophiles and those guys, because those people will obviously they get targeted. So if there's a special place for them, they'll probably put a trans person right there or something like. When I thought of it, I thought it was funny, but I was like. I hate the concept of pedophilia. It's very triggering for me. I think I have a lot of I have a lot of unresolved issues from my probably from my childhood molestation, or I have throughout my whole life I've always minimized that. I was seeing this video yesterday about this trauma recovery thing, and they were talking about minimization and how minimization is, it leads to re-victimization. So I have been minimizing my own kind of Because I thought, oh, okay, all right. Well, when it happened, I thought I was gonna die. I really, the experience when it happened, I thought this guy was going to kill me and my life was over. So that was a very shocking, traumatic event for me. But all I did was I felt ashamed. After what had happened, I felt shame, you know. I just felt like I was stupid. Like, why did I go there? I was trying to buy a Walkman, and I was so desperately going to all these shops trying to find Walkman, and I walked into this guy's shop, and so when it happened, I thought I was really literally gonna die, and it was very shocking for me. And I never really spoke about it with anyone. When I remember when I went home, I felt very guilty and ashamed, and I probably was shaking. I think when he let me go, he actually gave me some money. So I guess he thought, keep my mouth shut or something. And when I w got out of that place, I just felt so relieved. Like I felt like I was. It's an amount of relief I felt that he let me go, because I thought he was gonna kill me. And when I was walking home, I remember like when I walked out, I saw this guy who was standing outside the shop, and I thought that he was looking at me, and I felt ashamed. I felt like, oh, you know, like when someone takes advantage of you or abuses you like that, you feel like, oh, I feel like I wasn't strong enough to defend myself. I felt like, I felt weak, and that made me feel ashamed as well. And I thought this guy was judging me. And when I went home, I remember walking home, and I felt so guilty, and I didn't tell about it to anybody. I didn't, I just went home, and my mom was there. I didn't tell her, and I told nobody. I kept it with me for, I don't know, for. I think the first time I actually mentioned it was years later, maybe when I was 18 or something. I just mentioned it to my sister, but they don't really understand it. You tell them and they just don't get it. They don't understand the experience. So I've never really dealt with that. I've never really spoken about it in a non-minimizing way. I've always minimized my experience. So maybe that has something to do with, I don't know, lots of issues I might have. It's really shocking to know that you feel like you're gonna die, and then to the next moment you're like giving your life back. It's like very traumatic. I did some voice practice. I've been neglecting my diet. My moods have been so bad over these past few days. It's just like, oh, so bad. I've been drinking like coffee and eating emotional eating, and it's my mental health hasn't been good at all. It's been absolutely horrible. But I seem to be doing okay today. I seem to be doing okay. And I remember like months later, I walked past that place with my family and my dad and all. And I remember when I was coming near that shop, I started getting angry, and I saw him. I saw him like on the. I just looked into the shop, and he was serving a customer, and I was like, I felt so angry at him. I was like, oh, I hate. I just felt this anger. Yeah, you shouldn't minimize experiences, no matter what they are. If you minimize it, it's actually re-victimizing or something. Yeah, link to that video. It's a good channel. It's called Trauma Recovery University. They talk about child sexual abuse, but also other kinds of abuse as well. So, Yeah, my voice is like, I'm unhappy with my voice, and I'm just not, kind of unhappy with lots of things. I am unhappy with lots of things. So what books did I buy lately? Let's see. Let me go to my Audible. My Audible. I have it pinned on my favorites. Oh, I did order some books as well. So I'm like so into books right now. Mainly therapy books. Yeah, so self help and mental health and come on. Oh, so for Kindle, I bought John Bradshaw's Homecoming, Pete Walker's The Tao of Fully Feeling, Harvesting Forgiveness Out of Blame, and Patricia Evans' The Verbally Abusive Relationship. Yes, I need to read that. She also wrote a book called Controlling People, and I got Pete Walker's Complex PTSD. I have the print version. And another one called Love is a Choice, the definitive book on letting go of unhealthy relationships. Another one called Safe People. Another one called The Psychology of Romantic Love. That's by Nathaniel Brandon, who's like a psychologist. So that's Romantic Love in an Anti-Romantic Age. And he also wrote another book called Honoring the Self. Honoring the Self. Another one by Daniel Goleman, Emotional Intelligence, Why It Can Matter More Than IQ. I have heard his name a lot. For my audiobooks, let me open my, well, I've been eating veggies too, so that helps my hair growth. So I got Wired for Dating, How Understanding Neurobiology and Attachment Style Can Help You Find Your Ideal Mate, Boundaries in Dating, How Healthy Choices Grow Healthy Relationships, Quiet, The Power of Introverts in a World That Can't Stop Talking. Yes, I am an introvert, believe it or not. I am a bit of an introvert. Anyway, another one, When the Body Says No, The Cost of Hidden Stress, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, which is like 126 hours and 31 minutes. Histories by Herodotus, Man for Himself, An Inquiry into the Psychology of Ethics. I've got a lot more books, I'm not reading all of them. I also got the complete NIV audio Bible. This is read by David Suchet, you know, Poirot. So apparently he's a Christian, and he had this, he became a Christian when he was 40, and he had this dream of reading the whole Bible. So he reads the Bible. It's 83 hours and 13 minutes, so I haven't read the whole Bible, so I thought I'll just... So, I've got The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich, A History of Nazi Germany by William H. Shira. This book comes a lot in history, like apparently this might be a very good book. Anyway, so that's a sum. I didn't read all of them, I left some out. Yeah, all right, so I gotta get going. It's 9:57. Fuck my hair. My hair is all just done. Jeez. You see, I've got all my bald spots. Actually, the hair is growing over it, but it's taking its time. And I have to take care of my... If I want to have good hair, I have to take care of my... I have to eat properly every day, not just like every now and then, you know. I have to just, you just can't just, you know, sometimes, stressed or whatever. Now my hair, look at it. There's no hair in here. It's like I've got hair, like it's growing. Like I've had, you know, new hair is growing, so that's good. But it's like I want to have better hair. I want to have better hair. So love that. Oh, I gotta get my stuff. Oh, what do I need? What am I supposed to do? Because this is what I'm supposed to bring. I had to put my old name in this. Damn it. I will bring my license. Yeah, I just need to lose some weight. You know, my stomach is a bit fat. It's a fat. Oh shit, my big forehead. But look, hair is growing, right? See, it used to be like, I think my forehead used to go back even more, so. But look, you know. I wish I had really good hair. I would really love to have good hair. I mean, but I transitioned late and I was already, you know, losing hair and I transitioned, so. I have to accept that, you know. Sometimes you just have to accept things like this. I wish I transitioned earlier. I wish I was born a girl, but I wasn't. So I have to deal with what I have. Where the hell is my... Oh, shit. Anyways, I'll sign off and I'll come back later. How do you hide there? Alright, so I just wearing this top. The top thing. So, oh shit. Well, maybe this is not a good style. It doesn't make my forehead look so big. Forehead looks so big, I don't know. Well, I need more hair anyway, so I also need to lose weight. I feel like my face might be a bit fat or something, I don't know. No need to be so nitpicky. So anyway.
Going up.
I'm in the scary, scary elevator.
Fifth floor.
Alright, so I just handed in the paper and the documents, and I'm going home now.
Ground floor.
I need to sleep. So it's 12:06 p.m. I came back, I ate some food, and having my second soy latte. And I just told my mom about that whole molestation thing. It's the first time I ever told her. And she was like, really? She just went quiet, and I felt very emotional saying that. And she said something like, this is what happens to kids or something. I don't know what she said, but people don't want to talk about things like that. That's another thing I learned with people. When you tell someone that you've been molested or abused or something like that, people are like, they just don't want to talk about it. Just it's very uncomfortable or something, I don't know. Well, it's kind of emotional for me to say it, so. But I... That's the first time I told my mother. about this incident, which took place when I was 11 or 12 or something like that, maybe even younger. I don't remember the age. Maybe I was younger. I don't know, 11, 10, 12, whatever. So,